Bam! Mr. Tarrou. Okay, if you were looking for a video of how to graph sine and cosine functions with all your changes in amplitude and phase shift and vertical shifts, this is not the video you want to watch. I just want to tie in, that'll be the next video I post. I just want to tie in how you get the numbers off the unit circle and how does that translate into a graph on the XY axis. Well, okay, so we have a unit circle drawn out, handy dandy. My kids are getting drilled now constantly or quizzed constantly about these unit circles. And the cosine is x over r and the sine is y over r. And since this is a unit circle, all the x coordinates therefore are cosine, and all the y coordinates around this unit circle are the sine values. Now, we're going to graph sine and cosine hopefully in the next 15 minutes. Just basic trig functions, no transformations, off the values we get from this unit circle. And when we plot points, when we graph these trig functions plotting that many points, we're going to need the help of our calculator. So I went ahead and did the square root of 3 over 2 and got 0.87. Now after this video, when I show you how I'm going to teach my own students to graph trig functions, they're not going to be allowed to use a calculator. So something's going to have to change from plotting all of these points. Okay, so we got y equals the sine of x. We're going to try and figure out what that looks like graphically. Now, I'm going to say x and y over here, but on a unit circle, which is on the xy axis, this is the origin, the x coordinates are cosine, the y coordinates are sine. But what you do as a graph of sine and cosine is you track the values of sine or cosine or tangent or whatever, but we're just doing sine and cosine today. We track those changes in those values over the x-axis, almost like over time. You know, as we rotate, what do those actual values become? So don't forget, what do you put into a trig function? You put in an angle measurement, and I'm going to do all my angles in radians. So the x-axis is actually the values of theta, because, you know, the x-axis is the domain, and we plug in angle measures to find, at least as far as trig functions are concerned, the ratio of the sides of a triangle. And in terms of sine, it's y over r. Okay, so let's see if we can't plot a bunch of points and just see what these basic functions look like of sine and cosine. So at 0 degrees, the sine of 0 degrees, the x-axis being the domain, theta, the sine of 0 degrees is 0. So we have the sine of 0 is 0. At pi over 6, we've got this vertical distance because sine is y over r, so when you rotate pi over 6 radians, the y value is 1/2. And I'll get a calculator for that. So the pi over 6, the y value is 1/2. At, let's say, pi over 3, well, if you rotate pi over 3 radians, the y value is, or the cosine value, is square root of 3 over 2, which we know is 0.87, or at least I did after I used my calculator, almost 0.9. So 0.3, at pi over 3, we're at almost 0.9. We're basically just in the middle. This is only, I mean, I'm doing more than just a sketch, but it is chalk and a chalkboard. So 0.9, 0.87, I can't tell the difference visually. At pi over 2, let's pick a different color here. Pi over 2, at 90 degrees, the y value is what? When you rotate pi over 2 radians, the sine value, the y coordinate on the unit circle, the sine of pi over 2 is 1. So, boom, there we go. And if there's been no transformations, like if there's no amplitude change, which I'll speak about in the next video, the highest your sine value will ever get is 1, because the y value and the radius are the same because you're moving perfectly vertically, or up and down, perfectly vertically. Anyway, so the radius is 1, the y value is 1, thus you get the largest value sine can take on without an amplitude change of 1. Now as we rotate back over here to 2 pi over 3, we're starting to come back down the circle, so the y values are going to start to reduce or get smaller. So the sine of 2 pi over 3 is once again square root of 3 over 2, or once again basically 0.9. Now why again does pi over 3 and 2 pi over 3 have the same basic coordinates except for a sine change? Because they both have the same reference angle of pi over 3 radians, or if you were in degrees, it'd be 60 degrees. You might notice also that I skipped over the pi over 4. Because when you count or set up an x-axis or any axis on a graph, you can't change by what you count. So I can't count by 30, then count by 15 and 15 and back by 30 again. And you can see I've already got a crowded x-axis, and I certainly do not want to count by half or 15 degrees, which would be pi over 12. So I'm just going to count by 30s as we go around the unit circle, since that's how I've set up my x-axis, which is representing theta, the domain value. As we come back over here at 5 pi over 6, the y value is again 1 half. The y value is again reducing, so 1 half of pi over 6. At pi, the sine value is 0. Now, these values are going to seem to start repeating, but they're all going to be negative because we're falling below the x-axis, which means your y values are negative again, of course. So at 7 pi over 6, we get negative 1 half. At 3 pi over 4, we get negative square root of 3 over 2, which is basically negative 0.9, 0.87. At negative 3 pi over 2, we're once again down at the bottom. We're at a quadrantal angle. I did that in orange. We did a quadrantal angle, and the sine value down there, the y value at 3 pi over 2, the sine of 3 pi over 2 is negative 1. That's going to be the lowest value that sine can take on unless there's a stretch, unless there's an amplitude change. Because, again, the y value and the r value are identical. So, we get negative 1. And then coming back up into quadrant 4, our y values start to rise again. So negative 0.9, basically, negative 0.87. And then negative 1 half. And then we're finally back to 0. So my sine graph looks like this. Now, if I keep that pattern up going on, hopefully you catch on to that. If you not, just ask me a question. Oh, I didn't hear any. Okay, so again, 30 degrees. And again, I'm highlighting all those angles that have the same reference angle. So they all have very similar coordinates. And if I keep this pattern up without all the colors so I can speed this up, one tick over instead of a 0.5, I'm at negative 0.5. One tick over, now I'm at negative 0.9. One tick over, I'm at negative 1. Now I'm going back up to negative 0.9. And another tick over, negative 0.5. Then at 0 again, another tick over, I'm at, let me see. When I'm back at 0, another tick over means I'm at 0.5. And then at 0.9, basically, 0.87. 1, 0.87, 0.5. And then finally at 2. So if I connect all these dots, I get that picture. And by the way, these are negative angle rotations, right? So negative pi over, I didn't include the negative, so I kind of skipped some values. But negative pi over 3, or negative pi over 6, negative 0.5, negative pi over 3 is negative 0.87, negative pi over 2. Now this says 3 pi over 2, but those are coterminal angles. So negative pi over 2 radians, negative 1, and so on. And look what we have. We have a nice smooth wave. This could be sound wave, waves in the ocean, electrical waves, light waves. It's a sine graph. And you might notice that with this graph, you can rotate it 180 degrees and it'll be a perfect match. It would line up exactly. If you can take a graph and rotate it 180 degrees, that means that this is an odd function. Let's take a look, if we have time, at cosine. And I'm going to do this a lot quicker, so I hope you understood that when you saw me do it, saw me work it out. Cosine, well, y equals cosine of x. We're still going to plug in angle measures, but when we evaluate cosine, we're not looking for the y values around the circle, we're looking for the x values around the circle. So the cosine of 0 degrees is 1. Let's use a completely different color. I'm not sure if the yellow and the white are going to really highlight that much of a difference. So the cosine of 0 is 1. The cosine of pi over 6 is square root of 3 over 2. We've heard that number before again. Square root of 3 over 2, which is 0.87. So pi over 6, 0.87. At pi over 3, our cosine value of pi over 3 is 1 half. at pi over 2 where cosine is 0, right? X value, so 0. At 2 pi over 3, the cosine of 2 pi over 3 is negative 1 half. And hopefully as I draw this, you can see the pattern showing up on our graph. At at 5 pi over 6, our cosine value is negative square root of 3 over 2, or negative 0.9 basically, negative 0.87. I don't know why I just say that instead of correcting myself every time. And then at pi, we're now to the farthest left on the circle as we'll get. So the x value is going to become as negative or as small as it'll ever get, and that's negative 1, and the radius is 1. So the cosine of pi is negative 1. Okay, if I can stop pointing to the unit circle, well, I'll do one more. I'll finish it up. And then we start in quadrant 3 and 4, having the x value start to become more and more positive or larger. So at 7 pi over 6, we're at negative square root of 3 over 2, or basically negative 0.87. And at 4 pi over 3, 1, 2, 3, 4 pi over 3, the cosine is negative 1 half. At 3 pi over 2, our x value is 0. At 5 pi over 3, we're at 1 half. And then finally, we're back at 0.87. And again, at 1, if I keep that pattern going on the other side, let's see what you can see so far. Here is y equals the cosine of x. So I probably should have that in blue, not yellow, because, well, whatever. Now, if I keep that pattern up, 1, 0.87, 0.5, 1, negative 0.5, negative 0.87, negative 1. I'm going this way now. You see my negative angle, so I'm wrapping this way around the unit circle. And negative 7 pi over 6, we're at negative 0.87, then at negative 0.5 again, negative 1, positive 1 half, positive 0.87, and positive 1. So again, negative pi over 3, square root of 3 over 2. Negative pi over 6, square root of 3 over 2. Negative pi over 3, 1 half. Negative pi over 2, 0. Showing you these points. Negative 2 pi over 3, negative 1 half. Negative 2 pi over 3, negative 1 half. Are you seeing the connection there, I hope? So we get this graph. And that is y equals cosine of x. Now, do you see the symmetry we have on the y-axis? If you have a graph that's symmetric to the y-axis, that means it is an even function. That might come in handy with some of our problems that we deal with later. So that is how we track rotation along the x-axis and pull those numbers off the unit circle. Now, in the next video, you're going to see me, you know, we don't want to do all these plotting points. We want to make this quick and as easy as possible. And with my students, I'm not going to allow them to use a calculator, because what I'm going to show them how to do, and you on the video, is show you how to just find those easy values of 1, of 0, 1, 0, negative 1, and 0 again. We are going to, in the next video, key in on just finding those key points. And when you're finding sine and cosine values of 1 and 0 and negative 1, now we're just talking about the quadrantal angles. And those, we'll talk about a system that we can use for doing a t-table that will allow us to only get these quadrantal angles and thus be able to do this kind of graph without the aid of a calculator and not without plotting so many freaking points. Woo! I'm Mr. Chiru. Go do your homework.